Julie Nutting's Etched Wood Ornaments were recently released by Prima Marketing. In today's video, I'll show you how I paint the faces, add color to the rest, and options for embellishing them. Whether you hang them on your tree or in unexpected places, you'll find them a really nice holiday decor item. There are currently 6 designs in the Etched Wood Ornament line from Julie Nutting and Prima, and each of them contains 3 pieces. There's a pair of wings, there's the actual ornament itself, and then packaged separately in here, you can see, is a length of ribbon, a tassel, and though I can't see it, there is a jump ring in there someplace. Now, these are made from some sort of manufactured wood. It's MDF, it's masonite, it's something along those lines. So it's nice and smooth, it doesn't have to be sanded. But it's brown, and if we leave it this brown color, at least it's been my discovery, that if you leave it this brown color, that underlying brown color is going to affect every other color that you put on top. So to give it more of a white and neutral base to start from, I'm just putting a very light coat of gesso on. Now, you'll notice that there's all of this etching area in here. What I don't want to do is fill that with gesso or paint unless I'm deliberately trying to conceal it. I want to leave that sort of etched area on there because it's very much part of the design. So all I'm doing is very lightly applying some of the Dina Wakely gesso. And again, if you're careful, you won't bury it down inside the etching. Now, the one thing that I will tell you is that on the face, because I want the, or actually, let me take that back. On the face and on any exposed skin parts, I'm going to put an extra coat of gesso because I really don't want the brown color underneath to alter the color on the face at all. So, and I actually missed here the first time I went through and did this, so let's get that done now. And it doesn't take very long to dry at all. This layer of gesso is so thin that it's ready to go in almost no time. So I'm just going to add a little bit more white here on her neck and on her face, so I know that I'm going to get truer color when it comes time to go ahead and do her face. And that's actually what we're going to do next. I like to start with the faces first. I think that they give me a little bit of idea about where I'm going with the rest of the design. There are going to be a lot of variations in how these can be embellished or put together. You can put the wings on, you can not put the wings on. There's various ways that you can set the wings. So there's going to be lots of options, but for me, the starting place really is the face. So let's put that to one side for a second. And let me bring in 3 colors from Dina Wakely's Heavy Bodied Acrylic line. Primary colors, red, blue, and yellow. You hear me all the time talk about if you mix colors that are opposite one another on the color wheel, you're going to get a muddy color. Well, if you want to make brown, you can use these 3 colors. Now, I will tell you that I learned this from Dina, taking the 3 primary colors, mixing them together, and then I tend to mix a little bit into white. And that way you can get flesh tones, whether you're talking about ethnic flesh, you're talking about Caucasian flesh, or anything in between, you can get those tones with these 3 colors. Now, you might want to add a little bit more of one color or another in order to approximate ethnicity, however you choose to do that. But more or less, the way to get a good flesh color is to start with roughly equal amounts of these. So because I only need to mix a little tiny bit of flesh for this one ornament right now, I'm just going to mix up about the same amount each of these 3 colors, and I'm going to have way more than I need here, but you can only work with so small amount, or before you know it, you don't have anything to work with. So I'm just going to use my palette knife, and I'm going to mix this up, and it's going to make a brown color. Now, Dina has said that the umber in her paint line is more of a cool brown. This tends to be, I think, a little bit more of a warm brown when you do it this way, and so when you put this with white, it makes something that starts to look like that pinky, peachy, camel-y kind of flesh color. Again, depending on how much of each of the colors that you put into it. Now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to pick this up and I'm going to kind of put it over here. Clean my palette knife off. Because what I want to do next, and of course I've hidden the white. Where did I put the white? What I want to do next is bring in the white. Is this it? Nope, that's not it. There it is. I want to bring in the white and actually go ahead and mix this. Again, I don't need very much. So what's here, yeah, and that's already too much of the brown, but that's all right. I can add some more white. But you can see immediately that you take on this kind of flesh tone. Now, if I think that this is wrong in any one direction, I can certainly modify it. If I think this needs to be just a touch peachier, I'll bring back in some of the ruby, and I'm going to use just the tiniest little amount to affect that color. And mixing paint, mixing the colors that you're looking for, very much becomes a practice thing. You will get better as you do it, I promise you will. And I can tell you that I rarely mix the same color more than once. They're usually close, so I try to be certain I have enough to do whatever it is that I'm working on, so I have a good color. All right, so that looks reasonably good. And by now, after all that mixing and chatting, I'm sure the gesso on this piece is dry. When I'm working on these ornaments, when I'm working on what I think of as the main elements, I use this filbert brush. I like the way that it's shaped. It's narrow. Because it's a filbert, it's narrower at the end of the tips than it is at the ferrule. It comes to a very rounded, I hate to say point because it's not a point, but it comes to a very rounded edge. Now, obviously these are heavy body acrylics, and I don't want them quite that thick, so I'm going to pick some water up from a bucket that I have off to the side that you can't see. And I'm just going to thin this a little bit so that it's more like a liquid style paint, whether you're talking about a fluid acrylic or something else, whether you're talking about the bottled craft acrylics. I just need this to be a little bit thinner than it comes from the bottle. And so I can continue to play with that until I have a consistency that I like. Now, I really don't want all that paint jammed up in the brush. Again, when I paint this, I'm going to try to avoid painting inside the etched area. So I'm just going to very lightly start applying this paint. I find, first of all, I can't talk and do this particularly well, but I find that you can shape the bristles of the brush. Now, you just saw me do this, and what I did was I took the bristles and I formed them into a tiny little edge, I guess, is the way to describe it. And what I'm going to do is take that edge and just very lightly put some of the flesh color in here. Chisel edge, that was the word I was looking for. I just want to really lightly get some of the flesh color in here. Alright, so now I'm going to continue along here. And again, I find that this brush really lets me do what I need to. I get reasonably smooth coats of color, and I'm pretty happy with the results. Now what I want is a nice smooth coat. I don't want to see brush strokes, if at all possible. So again, I'm going to reform this into a chisel so I can come in here in the area where there's a little separation in her bangs, and I can get some color in there. Now these are pretty small elements, but you can do some very basic shading on them if you want. And you'll see that I'm not actually going to put facial features on here other than to blush her cheeks a little bit. I think that they're really nice the way that they are, and they don't need a whole lot more than that. But having said all that, if you want to add facial features to yours, then of course go ahead and do that. All right, so that looks pretty darn close. Now, if I wanted to shade this, the first thing that I'm going to do, and let me grab a pin, if I can find what I did with it. I got a little bit of paint right in here. So this is the pin that I use to unplug bottles of Stickles and liquid pearls. I'm just going to come in here and ever so lightly see if I can pull the paint out of that little etched area. And if it doesn't come out, it's not the end of the world. All right. So while this is still damp, I want to go ahead and shade her a little bit. If you think about the way light falls on an object, typically you're going to see a shadow right under the neckline because your chin and the lower half of your face is going to provide a little bit of shadow under there. And you would also see a little tiny bit of shadow under her bangs. So I'm going to pick up some of this color here. And what I want to do is just create a slightly darker version of the color that I'm working with. And if I think this is too dark, I can always fix it. But all I want to do is ever so lightly just darken this enough so that there is a hint of a suggestion of perhaps a little bit of shadow falling under her bangs. And when you work with the paint wet like this, it allows you to do a little bit of brush blending. Again, if you don't feel like you want to do this, then don't. Not a big deal. I won't tell anybody. But if you want to get a little bit adventurous and you want to try for something that's a little bit more realistic looking, then by all means give it a try. At worst, you coat it with some more paint in her facial color, and you start again. It's really not the end of the world. Whoops. So what I'm going to do now is make certain I have the basic flesh color in my brush, and I'm just going to come back and ever so lightly tap that just to smooth the color out a little bit so there are no harsh lines. Once I'm satisfied with her face, and I pretty much am here, what I'm going to do now is again pick up some more of my darker color, and I just want to add the hint of a shadow underneath her neckline. Now we could talk about the direction that the light is coming from, but this piece is so small, I'm not really feeling compelled to do that, so I'm just going to let it alone. So what I want to do now, let me just put this brush in the water for a moment, and I really don't like wasting all of this paint, but I'm basically done with these colors. There are no other exposed areas of flesh on here. So I'm just going to wipe this up. Actually, you know what? I think I'm going to leave a little bit of that there just in case I need it. What I'm going to do now is blush her cheeks ever so lightly. So for that, I'm going to bring back a little tiny bit. Let's just clean this off. A little tiny bit of red and a little tiny bit of magenta. Now, you can blush her cheeks. Here's a couple that I've already done. You can blush her cheeks. I take that back. Here's two that I've already done. You can blush her cheeks so that they're a little bit more pronounced, or you can be a little bit more subtle. In all those cases, I pretty much have worked with, where's my magenta? With magenta and ruby and a lot of white, because all I want to do is just ever so slightly suggest that she's got a hint of color in her cheeks. All right, so now what I'm going to do is I'm going to come back, pick up some of this color, and I'm going to come back with my original flesh color. And I'm just going to ever so lightly touch this in her cheek area. And I can already see that that's not quite dark enough. I'm hoping that this isn't so subtle that you can't see it, but I think that you will be. And again, all I want to do is ever so lightly just put the suggestion that she's got a little bit of color in her cheek area. As I said, it helps if you do this when her actual face is damp. It allows you to do a little bit more blending. I think I need just a smidge more there. This is probably the pickiest part of the entire piece, but I think that her face is very important, and so you want to be certain that you do a good job with this, which is why I like to do the face first. Then it's out of the way and I don't have to worry about it. All right, so she looks pretty good. She's got some pink on her cheeks, and now we're going to talk about adding color to her hair and her outfit, and we'll talk about various things that you can do to the element. Now this is a star. This is kind of an ornament shape. This is just round. But I want to talk about the various options that there are for these things, because some of them, it's not going to matter what you put underneath, because you're going to put stickles or other kinds of glitter on there. There's so many ways that you can embellish these that a little bit of thought in the beginning will help you figure out where you're going and how to get there. This red and green sample is the first one that I created, and it's very obviously Christmas because of the colors. Red and green are very traditional for Christmas, but that doesn't mean you have to go with those colors even if you want these for your Christmas decorations. So with that in mind, one of the other combinations that I really like for Christmas is turquoise or blue and silver, and that's kind of where I'm going here. Now, as I said a moment ago, sometimes it's the paper that helps me figure out where I'm going. I will confess that I knew I wanted to go with silver and blue or turquoise, and so I grabbed, this is from the Bow Bunny, this paper pad is called Zippity Doodle, and it has all of these wonderfully colored papers in it that kind of fit with my theme, and I chose these two as potentials. So I have this piece here, and I can kind of put this behind her for a little bit more modern look. Or I can put her on here. I haven't really decided yet. Now I have another one. I'm going to work on this one just to show you a little bit of what I did with the painting. And I don't know which one I might want to put on here, although I kind of like the zigzags with the star just because it's very angular and graphic, and I think that it kind of works with this piece. So maybe I'll go kind of this route and see how that works. But in the meantime, really what's next is very much paint by number. I know what colors I'm going to use, so let me get the paper out of the way. and bring in the paint. Now I'm using Viva Decor's Maya Gold. It's wonderfully shimmery paint. It covers really well. It's really easy to work with. It's water-based. It's everything you could want in a paint with shimmer. So I've chosen to use three colors. My base color for her clothing, like what I did here, is going to be the color that's called turquoise. And if I turn this, you might just be able to see that there are some shaded colors in here that I used olive for, and then silver so far on her hat, and the outer portion of this is going to be silver. So let me come back and let's start with here, and we'll talk about how I went about this. So this is the turquoise. Again, I'm going to come back to my filbert brush, and I need to get some clean paper towel. Okay, here we go. So I've got my filbert brush, and all I'm going to do is put a little bit out on my nonstick craft sheet just so I have something to work from. And again, it's paint, it truly is paint by number. So she's got hair going on here, bangs in the front. She's got some holly berries and leaves on her hat, and this is the top of her hat. I might make that white because my plan is to use glitter. You all know that I'm very fond of glitter, so this is really my opportunity to use glitter. Now, as I film this, it's virtually Halloween. It's only a couple of days away. This video will probably debut in the early part of November. It's not too early for me anyway to begin thinking about working on my holiday ornaments. If I want to get anything done, or if I want to get more than one thing done, I really do need to start now. So all I'm going to do is come in and lightly come in and coat. Sorry, I can't talk and paint. Not if I want to do a good job of either, actually. So I'm just going to put a very light coat on here. Again, I want to avoid getting paint in the etched markings, if at all possible, because they help create definition. And what you ordinarily might do with shadow, you've already got in place here because you've got the etched markings. So this is really straightforward. What I'm going to do is just paint her jacket here, and then I'll shade it, and then we can talk about some of the other things. But the painting process is virtually the same for all parts of this. Okay, so let's just see if we can get this other side done. Now she's got some buttons on her coat. I'm probably not going to do anything to them. I believe what I'm going to do, once the paint is dry, is come in with some liquid pearls and create some dimensional buttons. I think that that will be fun. I don't know which color yet, but the plan is to use liquid pearls there to get some dimension. I just want kind of a different look. Now, if I think that this is too difficult to paint around neatly, I can just go ahead and paint right over them. The liquid pearls are pretty much opaque anyway, so in all likelihood, it's not going to matter a whole heck of a lot. But initially, my goal is to leave them open if at all possible. That way, I'll absolutely be able to see them when it comes time to put the liquid pearls on. One of the things that I try to do is smooth the paint out so that there are no obvious brush marks in it. There are no ridges where there's extra paint or anything like that. I think it creates a more finished look if the paint is nice and smooth and even. All right, almost there. Now you can just go a single coat with this, or if you want some more depth of color, you can go ahead and put a second one on. But for the sake of moving along and getting this done, I'm just going to go with the single coat. Although I can see a spot right here where the paint's a little bit thin. Okay, so that works. Let's go ahead and put that back in the jar. I'm going to just wipe most of the paint out, and I'm going to bring in the olive. Now, olive tends to be, it's a really gorgeous color, but it's gold. It has gold mica in it. This has probably blue in it. I don't see it as silver at all, but the thing with this is that it tends to look a little bit greener because of the gold that's in there. So I'm going to put a little bit out, and I'm going to put just a little bit of water on my paintbrush because I want to thin it. All I want to do is think about where the shadows might fall if there was a light source coming on this. So probably along the edge here under her collar. And again, do you have to be perfect with this? Absolutely not. If you don't want to do this, it's really not necessary. It's just something you can do if you want to. All I'm doing is adding a little bit of this yellowy greenish, well, it's called olive, but I think of it as more of a turquoise. But all I'm doing is adding a little bit of that color in there just to give some dimension to her jacket. So that's pretty much done. I would do the exact same thing with all of the other elements on this, except that, let me grab the other brush. Let me clean the other brush. Except for all of the ornaments have this inner border that surrounds the inside edge of the ornament as well as the outside edge of the figure. Now I've chosen to go with white on all of mine. I think it really makes the image stand up off of whatever, whether it's the paper or it's around the ornament itself. I like the fact that this is a different color. Now here, I came in with stickles and went all the way around. I'm not going to do that here. The only thing that I would do differently is in order to do this edge really well, the filbert brush is not quite as easy, so I would take, and let me just put a little teeny bit out here and I can show you how I do it. I would take some of the Dina's white paint. I'm going to thin it just a little bit because it's a heavy-bodied paint and it tends to be thick. That's the nature of a heavy-bodied paint. But the nice thing is because it's very thick, it's very highly pigmented, you don't have to go over this with multiple coats. So is this picky? Admittedly, it's very picky, but I think that it's absolutely worth it. So all I do is just come in here, and you'll notice that I did this. If you get some paint on your brush and then you twirl it, you will actually form that tip into a nice tiny little point, and that will allow you to come in and just very lightly go around this piece and outline her and the inner edge of the ornament itself with white. Now you don't need to see me do any more than that, but that's the basic process. What I do want to show you, let me stick this back in water and clean this up. What I do want to show you is how I mix blonde for the hair. If it's brown or something along those lines, you can basically just use a little bit of brown or a little bit of black. It's entirely up to you. But I like to do things, of course, I like to do things the hard way. So that means I'm going to mix paint. Not that mixing paint is hard, but it, you know, it's not straight out of the tube. So I'm going to take just a smidge of the lemon. I'm going to come back and get this round, get my filbert brush. Clean that out because it's got quite a lot of turquoise in it. And I don't want her hair to be green, so if I don't want that, I've got to make sure I got the blue out of the brush. Okay, so I'm going to take a little bit of umber. It's here someplace. I know the cap is here. There we go. And my palette knife. And all I want to do is just deepen this yellow a little bit. And then I'm actually going to lighten it with some white. Now that might have been a little bit too much. We'll have to see. I'm trying to get kind of a mustardy color is where I'm going. Here's the yellow. This actually looks a little bit green because this is a cool brown. Alright, so let's see how that looks when we put some white nearby. I think I like that. Now, if you want to do yours, your ornaments, kind of fantasy style, then do their hair all different kinds of colors. They don't necessarily have to be what would be considered natural hair colors. So, again, I'm going to grab just a little bit of water so that the paint is a little bit easier to work with. And if I think I need to deepen it, I can always grab a little bit of this. And it's just a simple matter of coming in and filling in her hair. As we said before, if you want to shade this, you certainly can. And you can make all different kinds of variations of, you know, blonde and redhead and whatever hair color you want, even if that means going kind of the fantasy route. Something stuck in there. And that's basically it. If I want to, well, you know what, let me finish her bangs, and then I can just come in and shade a little bit under the edge of her hat, and maybe right along the edge here. Now you can see that I have so little paint on the brush that even though I'm brushing over the etch mark, it's really not filling it in, because again, I don't have tons of paint in here. So let me come and grab some of the darker color. And just mix a little bit, and then I can just come and darken, whoops, darken under here a little bit. And just a smidge under her hat. And that's pretty much it. So once you get all of your ornament done, then the question becomes, well, what are you going to do with the wings? What are you going to do in terms of what paper you want to put it on? So I'm going to finish these up, and then I'll come back and we can talk about options for the back, because when you put paper on the back, if I can find the Christmas one, here she is. If you put paper on the back, now this is a double-sided paper. This is from Tim Holtz's Merriment Paper Stash. That's what this piece is. And because it's double-sided, it means that I get a finished back along with the element, or the sides of it rather, that are showing through the ornament. With something like this particular Bow Bunny pad, the back of these papers are white, but that doesn't matter because you'll just have a nice finished white back on there. So we'll come back, we're going to talk about the papers, I'm going to talk about embellishing with fun things like liquid pearls and stickles. There are lots of ways to back your ornaments. I'm choosing to use paper so far, but you have lots of other options. You could use fabric, you could use lace. There's really a variety of ways to back them. So let's just talk for a moment about this star. And as I said earlier, I'm going to use this paper with it because I kind of like the angular look. But something like this works equally as well. You saw this a little few minutes ago. Now you'll notice that there's some glitter on this paper, which is not how it comes off the pad. So let's talk about that just for one brief moment. I'm using the Sakura Quickie Glue Pen and Ranger's Dry Stickles in the color Silver, and I'm just going to very lightly embellish this paper. Now, having said that, do you have to do this? Of course not. And I won't embellish the entire piece. What I will do is just the areas that are going to show through the star. And before I forget, this is just a matter of tracing your shape on the paper. Now, this hole is somewhere between an eighth and a quarter inch. So what I did was I just used a pen, I drew through the hole, and then I used my eighth inch hole punch and just carefully kind of chewed away at the hole a little bit at a time until I got it up into about that shape. If it's not perfectly round, which mine is not, you will never know the difference. But I know that this is my orientation on the top. So what I'm going to do is, let's just come back here for one second. Now I could choose to do all of these zigzags, or I could just do none of them. Excuse me, I could do all of these zigzags, or I could do just a little bit of them. So I think what I'm going to do, just to start with, is I'm going to go ahead and outline the bottom portion of this particular one. Now this glue will stay dry for, I don't know, 40, 50 seconds, maybe a little bit longer than that. I just tend to put the glue down and then put the glitter on fairly quickly, and you can tell when the glue is still wet because it will shine, it will reflect in the light. So all I'm going to do is just very lightly, and I'm not going to dump a bunch of glitter on here because I really don't need to, so I'll just do this kind of a little bit at a time. I'm going to scooch it around until the glitter's adhered, and then you can see that I get this really nice effect on the zigzag. It's really subtle. If I wanted to do some more, I could. But as I put this together, you can see how that's going to look if I catch that just right with the light. You can see that reflecting on there. So I probably will do maybe the dark blue one down here, maybe pick up some others in between just to give this a little bit of a kick. And then I always catch my glitter on a piece of scratch paper so I can put it back in the container. So that's one way to do this. Now you can also use plain old stickles if you want. So let me bring this round one back in. Now this theme on this one is pretty much silver and turquoisey blue. So what I'm going to do is use silver stickles. Now I don't know if I have enough in this bottle to go all the way around, but if I bring back in this one, you can see that I put one color stickles around the main border of the ornament, and then on this narrow border that I've typically painted white, I came in with another color stickles. I'm going to talk about that in 1 second. But all you have to do, stickles don't dry dimensional, so you can just go ahead and push some of this out, and I use the tip of the bottle to kind of alternate between squeezing and spreading so that I get the glitter where I want it. And this is certainly a way to really add some Christmas bling to your ornaments. Now, if you're choosing to do these for a holiday, or excuse me, something other than Christmas, and maybe a holiday, maybe not, you ease up on the glitter if you want, and then obviously it's a little bit different looking, but I really, for the holidays, I really like lots of glitter. So what I would do would be to just continue to go all the way around, trying to make certain that my coat of glitter is reasonably even, although having said that, if you find a little bare spot once it dries and it all settles down on that surface, it's a simple enough matter to go back and to just fill in. So it's not like you have to be perfect the first time around. So that's one option. When we talk about this inner border, I want to talk for 1 second about 4 different colors of stickles. You have diamond, I'm going to hold this one till last, stardust, and this is called crystal. I'm going to try to hold these into the light so that we get some reflection on here. And what you can see is that this is the diamond, and it tends to glimmer a gold color. This is the stardust, and it glimmers actually multicolor. This is the crystal, and you can see that it glimmers very definite green. Now, what I can tell you is that the base that the glitter is suspended in, that liquid glue, is clear in all of these cases. So what you will see is the color of the glitter. Now, icicle reminds me very much of diamond. It's the same colorway where it tends to shimmer gold, but the flakes of the flakes of glitter in here are far, far larger, so you're going to get a very different look. So let me bring in, what was I going to do with this? Where's my little star? Actually, I think what I'm going to do is let's get her backing paper out of the way. Get this out of the way. I think I'm going to use the icicle on her hat. So I'm going to get bigger flakes of glitter, and it's going to glimmer kind of goldish, which doesn't bother me. Which doesn't bother me, even though she is silver and turquoise. Now, the one thing that I forgot to mention, the opening, because of the size of the glitter, the opening in this, this icicle bottle is far, far bigger. So if you don't want to have happen what just did, then squeeze reasonably gently until you get the feel for how it's going to come out of the tip of the bottle. So this is going to dry chunkier than the regular stickles do, just for a little bit different look. Now you can see that I have a really narrow area here where her hat kind of, or the brim of her hat kind of comes around. So I'm just going to ease the stickles in place with this number 2 liner brush. And at the end of the day, it's not that big a deal if it doesn't end up totally in there. So there's one way. Now what you can see is on the inner border here, I actually used, I can never remember, this is crystal because it glimmers green. This is patina stickles around the perimeter here, and then I used the crystal color because it's green and I'm going with a green and red theme here. I could choose an entirely different color here if I wanted. It's really just one of those questions of playing till you see what you like. So I want to talk now about liquid pearls, and I'm going to come back to this star. And ordinarily, actually, you know what, before I forget, what I have done is I have put the outer color on, and before it's dry, I go back and put the inner color on. You don't have to wait. Just don't wiggle the tip, and it won't mix into what's already there. So I'm not going to worry about the fact that I just put the icicle stickles on her hat. This is liquid pearls. This color is garnet. Now what I do want to do is just bring in, well, now I have this all over the place. I want to bring in, just to make certain that I don't have a clog, which I can see that I do because it's been a while since I used this, and it does happen some of the time. If you want to get a fine line, you have to have a reasonably fine tip, which means that there are times when, if you haven't used it for a while, it's going to feel a little bit clogged. So I want to do this on a sample piece, and I want to make certain that I have that flowing rather than on my piece. So what I'm going to do is use the garnet on the holly berries in her hat. So I'm going to get the pearlescent glimmer, and I'm also going to get dimension because this will dry in the shape that it is in. Now this one looks a little bit small, so I'm just going to come back and fill it. Now, liquid pearls will sometimes want to dry in that rather kiss-like shape. So if I tap this lightly underneath, that'll help smooth out the round. And if I tip that, you can kind of see that those are nice little mounds. They don't have that Hershey Kiss looking peak at the top. So what I'm going to do now, I can't find my silver liquid pearls, so I'm just going to go ahead and I'm going to use white. And there's a little dot on her scarf that is kind of like a highlight. So I'm going to dot, this is white opal, I'm going to dot it on each of the buttons on her jacket. And I'm going to lift straight up each time. And I also dotted it on that little piece that is the highlight on her on the collar. Again, I'm going to give it a little tap. And so you can see how easy it is to come in and add some really cool texture, some fun shimmer, and lots of different things to go ahead and embellish the fronts of your pieces. Now you can go way over the top. You can keep them very simple. It really is entirely up to you. Before we talk about embellishing the wings and then putting the ornament together, I want to back up just for a second to a technique that I should have mentioned in the last segment and forgot to, and that's using glass glitter. Now this is crushed glass glitter. It's very chunky, quite vintage looking, and it is glass, so you want to keep it away from the kids and the animals, but it's a very effective technique and I did want to show it to you. So here's a piece that I've kind of been working on. I've got half of her crown done. I'm going to bring in the Aileen's. This is the super thick tacky glue. And I'm going to place it reasonably carefully, the glue, I mean, so that I get some control about where my glass glitter is going to end up. Now, if I want chunky, like I did, let's see if I can bring this. Well, no, I can't. So we'll just ignore that. But I'm going to post some photos of the finished ornaments on the page at the website where this video will be posted. And you'll be able to see that that round ornament that is the silver and the turquoise has glass glitter on it too. And unlike here, where I'm being very fine and very deliberate and keeping my layer of glue reasonably thin, on that one I really blobbed the glue on so that not only did I get the glass glitter, I also got some dimension with that glass glitter. So I'm fussing a little bit here because you kind of need to in a small area like this, but because the results are really nice, I think it's worth the effort. So with the glue in place, all I'm going to do is just pick up the glass glitter and sprinkle it where it needs to be. I'm going to let it just sit for a second. I'm going to knock off the excess, and then you can see that this crown has become pretty indistinct because this is such chunky glitter. So what I'm going to do is come in and tighten this up by just pushing the glitter into shape on the spikes of her crown so that it looks like the crown has those little spiky peaks, and it also doesn't just fall over her hair and change her hairline. And this allows me to be a little bit more precise, but with a chunky glitter, and I like it because it has such a nice vintage look to it. You just have to be a little bit more careful when you're working on a small element like this, but you can see how effective that is. Now I'm going to leave this ornament here because she is actually one of the reasons that we're talking about this segment, because I have a set of wings that I made and I then didn't know what to do with them. I like to play sometimes and then I realize that I've gone off in a direction that I don't have anything to work with. So these are some wings that I did way back in the beginning when I started to play with this project. And if I hold these up, you can see that there's glitter in there. Now the interesting thing is that this is a combination of embossing powder and glitter. And let's just move this out of the way. This is actually a package from Stampendous. If I can get this open, that includes 5 different embossing powders. 3 of them have glitter in there as a matter of course. So I'm going to take out this blue one, which I'm going to use, and then I'm going to take out the gold version, which is what I used on these wings. And you can see the glitter in there. Now, with most glitter, because it's a synthetic product, you can't get it near heat or it shrivels up and it dies. It does not like heat. But when you work with an embossing powder that has glitter in it, the glitter has been chosen to go in that embossing powder with full knowledge that it's going to have to stand up to the heat, whatever amount of heat is necessary to get the embossing powder to melt. So you can't just emboss any old glitter, but you can choose glitter that is named embossing glitter, or you can choose a combination like this that has glitter in it. So I'm not going to do this gold color again. I've already got one pair, and they're going to go with her. Now, how you arrange your wings is very optional, but there's lots of different ways. You can do something like this, where the wings are facing down. You can have the wings kind of be more midline like this. Or you can really turn them upward like this. There's an endless variety of ways that you can do this. And you can have the wings kind of mid-ornament like this, or you can cheat them a little bit more toward the top, depending on whatever it is that you want to do. So let me show you how to get the color on the wings. Now, these are going to go, where is the star ornament? I have put it someplace. Ah, here it is. All right, so these are earmarked for this ornament right here. Now, having said that, I don't know how I'm going to place them yet, but I do know that I want to use this version of the glitter. It's called something blue, I think. The whole thing is called, well, I don't remember what the whole thing is called, and the name is not on here, but the color that I'm using in here is shabby blue. It's got that blue glitter with the white and some gold embossing powder in there. So what I'm going to do, I haven't decided yet if I'm going to have these wings arranged like this or in whatever configuration, but let me show you how to get the color on there. Tim Holtz's Distress Embossing Ink, it works really well. You can pretty much choose any ink that will stay open or wet for a while. That's what the difference is between most embossing inks and any other kind of ink, is that they're meant to stay wet longer. I'm going to just do one of these because really you don't need to see me do more than that. But I'm going to take, now you can't do this with a dried out pad, so be certain that you have a pad that's got some juice in it. All I'm going to do is just pretty much cover this wing with the embossing powder. Excuse me, with the embossing ink. And if I turn this, let's see if I can get that. Here we go. I get that to reflect in the light. You can see that it's shiny all over, except for maybe right there. I might have missed. Then what I'm going to do is just take the embossing powder and dump it on here, and you see how pretty that blue glitter is. And the nice thing is it's going to stay blue. It's not going to change because of the heat from the heat tool as I melt the plastic. So then I'm just going to go ahead and knock off all the excess. Now I'm not going to make you watch me emboss this. You all know what embossing is. I'm going to heat it. The heat's going to activate the plastic that is the embossing powder. It'll melt and it'll be a done deal. And it'll end up looking something along these ideas. So I'm just going to get this out of the way right now, but that's basically what I'm going to do to the wings. Now, what could you do with them besides this? Many, many things. You could cover them with paper. You just, the same way that you trace the paper for behind the ornament, you can trace the wings onto paper, and you can put that on the front. You could put some texture paste on here to make something that looked a little bit more dimensional, like feathers on a wing. You could layer some things on there, maybe some thicker pieces of paper, lots of different ways to do that. So let's move on now and talk about finishing the ornaments. As I said way back in the beginning, each ornament included in the package is that length of ribbon, there's this nice jump ring, and a tassel. Now you'll notice that this tassel does not look like this tassel because this tassel has been glittered, so we're going to talk about that. Obviously, always optional. You don't have to do it if you don't want to. But before we talk about that, I want to talk about rayon seam binding. This is regular polyester ribbon of one sort or another. Let's see if I can get this, whatever that's on here. It feels like there's a little piece of tape. Let's see if I've got one that's open. All right, this is a turquoise one. So this is just regular old polyester ribbon. I'm sure that's what it is. And of course, it's got this piece of tape on here that I can't get off. There we go. What I would do would be to take this to the ironing board. I would mist it very lightly and then press it to get those wrinkles up. But at the end of the day, this is still polyester ribbon, and while it's pretty, I'm not exactly certain it's the look that I want. So what I've done instead is taken, this is just some rayon seam binding. I cut off a length, put it on my table, spritzed it with, I want to say it was probably cranberry from the color wash line, and I think I used a little bit of cherry pie from the dilutions line, crunched it, dried it, and then you have this kind of crinkle look. So I took a piece and I fed it to the top. That will make a nice hanger if I choose to do that. It's entirely up to you. There's just a million different ways to do this. You can also tie this into a little bow. If you want to find a way to try to incorporate the bow, you can certainly do that if you choose. Now, when it's time to attach the tassel to the bottom. These jump rings are large enough that I'm going to guess, yeah, they're big enough. You don't really need pliers. You can do it quite easily this way with your fingers. So all I'm going to do is put that through there. Oops, attach the loop on the tassel and then close the jump ring. And you have this kind of look here, which means now I have this tassel hanging on there. So if you would like, because, you know, glitter is your world too, if you'd like to glitter this, let me show you how easy it is. Again, coming back to the, I'll be darned, where did it go? Here it is. Coming back to the diamond color of Stickles, because that's the one that glows kind of a gold color. All I did was just take this and lightly kind of spritz a little bit, and spritz is not a bad word, but not a good word, but squeeze out a little bit here and there, and that's just the little metal top to the tassel that's popped off. All I have to do is feed that back through, but let's talk about the glitter. So all you have to do is just kind of touch this on there, and then because this is glue, I want to keep this from sticking together, so I'm just going to push all of these little pieces of the tassel, all the little dangly bits, in such a way that they're not going to stick together. You can also come in, you can see that, well, you can't hear, but you can put a little bit of your Stickles on the top of the tassel if you want, and on that piece where it's all tied together, and you just kind of touch it in place, and that's it. So, you know, there's 6 different styles of the etched wood ornaments. Julie and Prima have done a wonderful job creating these. They're nice quality. There's an unlimited variety of ways that you can utilize them. And remember, just because Christmas is around the corner, they make wonderful gifts. They make wonderful ornaments for your tree. You can hang them on a doorknob, but they don't have to be Christmas. You can pretty much do them to suit whatever your needs are.